Hello everyone and welcome. It's my great pleasure this evening to introduce Dr. Aaron J. Brody, Robert and Catherine Riddle Professor of Bible and Archaeology at Pacific School of Religion in Berkeley, California, and Director of the Baudet Museum of Biblical Archaeology. He has studied and worked on projects in Israel, Palestine, and Jordan, and traveled extensively throughout the Middle East and Mediterranean. And he has held research posts at both the University of Haifa and the American Center for Oriental Research in Amman, Jordan, and is currently a National Endowment for the Humanities Fellow here at the Albright Institute. Recently, his research has focused on household archaeology, household religion, metallurgy, ethnicity, identity, and interregional trade at Tell and Nesba as modes for understanding the complexities of everyday life of ancient biblical peoples. His research interests include biblical and archaeological interpretations of the society, religion, and economy of ancient biblical lands and the modern Middle East, as well as archaeology and the study of religions, race, ethnicity, gender, and sexuality in archaeology in the biblical world, and maritime and underwater archaeology. His fieldwork has been conducted primarily at Bronze and Iron Age sites on the Mediterranean coast of Israel, with participation in projects in the Negev, Akko Plain, and in Northern California. He'll be speaking today about household religion in the Iron Age II, based on analysis of ritual objects from Tell and Nesba. So please, everyone, welcome Dr. Brody, and thank you.
Thanks, Ian. Can everybody hear me okay? All right. And thank you for coming out on a rainy day. I feel like the storm god is with me. So so today I'll be discussing the materiality of religion in Israelite households, focusing in on examples from Tell and Nesba. So the religion or religions of ancient Israel have been the focus of recent studies. It's become a very popular topic. One of the main themes, as you can see in the upper left, is this approach that there's diversity among the religion or religions of ancient Israel and Judah. And I would say a subset of that sort of diverse approach to the study of ancient religion, which used to be really presented in a monolithic fashion, I would say, has been a focus on the household itself. So here you see two other examples. Again, recent studies of the household and family in the Mediterranean region, especially in the ancient Middle East, and then a focus on ancient Israel and Judah as well, but all fairly new publications. Oops. Now it's not working at all, so if you could just go forward too. Thank you. So with today's talk, I'm gonna focus in on the site of Tell and Nesba in the Iron II period. And the objects that we consider to be ritual objects actually were already published in 1947. Here you can see a couple slides from that original report. There's a chapter by C.C. McCallum on the, well, what we would call ritual objects. But part of the issue is that those reports are extremely hard to use contextually, and this chapter was essentially written from a typological perspective. So there was no separation out of different artifacts by different phases or anything like that. There really was just a presentation of the material kind of as is. And so what I hope to do today is to present a contextual analysis of these materials. Next, please. So here, for those of you who are not familiar with the site, we just had a recent Albright field trip to go to visit Tell and Nesba. It's located just off the trunk road, about 12 kilometers north of Jerusalem. Here you can see it linked on the slide, perhaps with the ancient city of Mitzpah. That's a whole other lecture, but I won't get into too much of that today. And on the right, you can see my predecessor at the Pacific School of Religion, I almost said Albright, but it's W.F. Baudet. We're in the house of Albright. with, well, his wife is to his left, and with other group members there from the 1935 expedition. The site itself, kind of the next slide, please.
Try it also.
Okay. So here you can see actually a fairly famous site plan of the site, although it's been phased by Jeff Zorn. Telemazbe itself is a 3-hectare site, and in five seasons between 1926 to 1935, about 2/3 of this ancient settlement was excavated. Here you can see there were five major phases that were found at the site. The latest three are represented architecturally in this image. The earlier two, so there's an early bronze one phase at the site and an iron one phase, but those are both only found in features or crevices that are in the bedrock, so they're not marked out architecturally. So if we come up though from the iron one, in the iron two period, that's the phase that's marked in black on this slide. So you can see there's a large feature, a city wall, offset inset wall, that surrounds the site, and then a series of structures on the interior. The next phase up, Jeff here has marked in red. He dates it to the Babylonian early Persian period. You can see it's much more limited than the Iron II settlement. And then finally, there's a phase that Jeff at least dates to the Hellenistic Roman period, and that's marked in green, and that is quite actually narrowly focused, fortunately for those of us who are interested in the earlier periods. But so today we'll be focusing in on the Iron II phase that's marked in black, and what you should notice here is that inside of that wall that surrounds the settlement are just a series of pillared houses. So there are no other architectural forms that were found in the 2/3 of the site that were excavated. There's no monumental architecture. There's nothing that could be interpreted as a shrine building or an official building. No public works except for the wall itself. We just have a series of pillared domestic structures. And so due to that, scholars like Jack Holliday interpret this site as being a fortified village, and I think that's an appropriate interpretation, at least in its late Iron Age phase. Next, please. Oh, I'm sorry, I can do this. Now, in comparison to the work that was, the excavations were done in the 20s and 30s, publications came out in the 1940s, the real treasure trove, at least for me, is that back in Berkeley, we have all of the original documentation from the site. And so while the final reports were very much a product of their day and are hard to use contextually, with some very large caveats, we can use the original documentation to do contextual analysis of the objects that we have from the site. So what I'm presenting here are some of the original architectural plans, or one of the plans. You see that on the left. It's at a much greater scale than the architectural plan that was presented in the final report. And then to the right, you have what are termed a millimeter card, or it's really an object records card. And they excavated, they divided the site itself into 10 meter squares and recorded things within those squares. And then when they hit architectural features or any other kinds of features, then they recorded the material within those features themselves. So if you notice the card on the right over there is from, I can't read it quite from here, but it's from room 454 or something like that. And so those objects are coming from a room that is defined architecturally. Now the drawbacks are that at the time, the locus itself was defined as the entire room. So within that room, 454 or any other room, we can't differentiate between where individual finds could have been located, how they related to other finds from within that room, above, below, next to, etc. So there are some contextual frustrations built into dealing with this kind of legacy material, but it's my feeling that that can be offset because of the breadth of excavation. Next, please. And of course, like anything else, working with the documentation is dependent on both the way things were excavated and also the way things were recorded as well. So here, just a few slides to remind us, again, that context in the 1920s and 30s meant something very different than it does today. And in general, in a nutshell, they were, at least at this site, they were very good at the horizontal and not so great at the vertical, if that makes sense to those of you who have excavated. The work itself, again, compared to modern work, was done at a very fast pace. Babe, who you can see in the upper right-hand image there, hired somewhere between 10 to 15 Egyptian foremen to oversee somewhere between 150 to 250 local Palestinian workmen, women, and children, some of whom you can see in the image there to the left. And so while, again, we have sort of the rudimentary beginnings of, if we can talk about archaeological science, the amount of earth moved to notes taken was, I would say, somewhat of the inverse that it is today. But what it does leave us, if I can advance the slide, is a much broader, so until today, this is still the most broadly excavated Iron Age site in the region. So hopefully, while we sort of lack some of the detail or the fine tuning, we can make up for that with the kind of breadth of presentation. And so today I'm not going to talk about, so here you can see again for the Iron II phase, that marked out in black, there are actually 42 of these pillared houses that were excavated. 10 of them were four-room houses. The other 32 are three-room houses or even two-room houses. And Jeff Zorn again has estimated that the population of the site was somewhere between 800 to 1,000 people, at least at its height. And so that, given that and the sort of architectural parameters, I do see this as being a large village. Now within that, today I will present a focused study on only five of those households. So those are the ones that are circled in red and then beamed up in the right-hand side of the slide. And so this presents a kind of case study. Earlier on, I did a household archaeology study, and I'll talk about that in just a second. But today we'll be focusing in on those five houses as a case study for trying to understand the materiality of religion in those connected houses. With a little background music. So in that earlier study, so this is a schematized version of those five interconnected or connected houses. And through looking at the material culture present actually in each room within these five houses, I was able to, and doing some statistics and that sort of thing, I was able to determine at least an interpretation for room use. And one of the interesting things here is that you can see, so in the center we have three very typical three-room houses. And in the upper part, it seems to be the case that each one of those back rooms was the living room. So the artifacts that were coded for those three rooms, 610, 612, 579, the ones circled in green, were related primarily to consumption and serving. And anthropological studies have shown that those types of objects tend to be the living spaces in traditional households. So those are circled in green. That seems to be the only pattern that repeats itself. When we look at the other rooms in these varied houses, first of all, there were a lot of the rooms that seem to have been devoted to storage, not an unusual thing for the ancient or even the modern traditional world. One of the interesting things, though, if you look at the rings circled in red, there are only two of them. So those show the greatest percentage of cooking wares. So right here and right here. So in other studies, I mean, I would say that scholars have basically said we have a kind of typical pillared house, and that the patterns within that will simply replicate themselves from house to house. And in this conglomerate of five of these houses, we don't really see that happening, because that would mean that the people in the middle houses over here have no place to cook, right? And so I think we need to start kind of thinking beyond that paradigm. And when one looks at these resources like cooking, first of all, those two rooms can be interpreted as a summer kitchen and a winter kitchen, something that's, again, very typical with modern traditional families living in villages. And it's probably the case the one that's further to the right, room 581, is actually the summer kitchen. And the one, because it probably was an open space courtyard, this one was an interior room, again, probably the winter kitchen. And then within that, again, within all of these rooms, there are only two workshops that I was able to define. That's the one circled in purple. And then finally, only one area that'll be the focus of today's talk, which I've termed a shrine, and that's marked in orange. And this sort of notion of shared resources between houses is actually a basic definition for the extended family. There are groups that work together in conjunction, and they share their resources. And so my overall interpretation of these five households is that they were occupied by three nuclear families, marked by the living spaces, marked in green, but were probably united not just physically by the connections between these houses, which share walls, but also societally, or in kinship terms, forming one extended family because of this notion of shared resources. So it's this, next please. It's within this compound then that I'll focus my presentation today. So within those five houses, one compound, there were a variety of objects that could be interpreted as ritual. And so here's just a kind of snapshot, an overview of those different types of objects. And for those of you who are familiar with the archaeology of the period, I think these should all look fairly typical. Animal figurines, female figurines, the pillar figurines. This is a fragment of a horse and rider. We had some other more unusual things, which I'll get into in more detail through the talk itself. And then also what's interesting too, and this is something that's more difficult to define, again, with legacy material or older excavations, you have something that has no sort of practical use, like the figurines, but there are other objects, like that jug that's in the lower right-hand corner, which has very utilitarian purposes. And yet it's found in this room with a cluster of other ritual objects. And so these are common objects that are interpreted as having been used in ritual, and so those are what are termed ritualized items. And that category is much more difficult to get at, I would say, with legacy material, because it's much harder to define within a given space what was going on in terms of interactions between ritual materials and ordinary materials. But it won't stop me from making some interpretive leaps. Next, please. Okay, so here's a contextual picture then of where these items were found within that five building compound. I also looked outside of the compound in the alleyways that surrounded these various buildings in case there may have been second-story rooms or other things that in their collapse or in their destruction would have deposited material outside of the rooms themselves. In that case, you can see that there isn't a large cluster of items from these alleyways. There are a few, so I think the green is animal figurines. You can see some here outside of the compound, one up there as well. This is some kind of apotropaic object as well found outside. So there isn't a huge, I would say, presence of ritual objects that are found outside of the compound itself. That and other reasons, I would argue that there probably were no upper story rooms in this particular set of buildings itself. Otherwise, this slide is a little bit muddied. And you should also pay attention here, too, because you'll notice that there are about half of the rooms within the five buildings actually have no objects that are considered to be have been used in rituals. So already, that's sort of separating out many of the rooms. And really, the only cluster is found right here, and that's the room that I showed you with the orange circle before. So, oops. Okay, when we take out, and it's pretty much about, with those other rooms where there are no clusters, there are one object per room, except for there's one area where there are actually two objects. But again, there are no clusters outside of that room. I think it's 513 that you can see here. And so for those, it's really hard to argue that anything is in any kind of decent context. And just as an example of that, what I have marked here in blue with the line through it are fragments of a fenestrated stand. It's basically an incense burner. And I think that these are actually two fragments from the same stand that were discovered in rooms that are at least 10 meters apart. So that already gives you an idea about how things have either been moved around or moved around in ancient times as well. And so it makes those objects outside of the room where you can see the cluster much less trustworthy. Again, this is legacy material, so it's hard to kind of separate out good context from bad context, but this is about as good as we can get given the state of the materials we have from the site. So I'll focus on then a presentation of the materials from that one room where we do have a cluster. And here you can see it, room 513, and some better images, I would say, of the variety of things that were coming from that one room itself. So fragments of, but also notice that everything is fragmentary. And so that also tells us something about the context. And but it's not just the ritual objects that were fragmentary, because in a moment I'll show you an image of some of the ordinary artifacts that were coming from this room itself. Those are also highly fragmentary as well. So it begs all kinds of questions, which are unfortunately very difficult, again, to approach because of the fact that this material was dug over 80 years ago. So anyway, I'll spend a little bit of time talking about these various artifacts and about some interpretive elements related to each one of them. So here you can see in this slide, this is the statistics related. There were 39, if you want to call them, profane artifacts from the site. Only 13% of them were related to cooking, 31% related to consumption or serving, and 56% related to storage. So presumably this is a storage room, right? If we read the artifacts that way. And here you see some of the materials that I worked on, some of the object records that allowed me to create these statistics. So, picking on my kids here, sorry. This begs the question though, was this a storage room that contained some sort of shrine? Or was it a shrine room that also had storage in it? And it's, I mean, your inferences are, I would say, about as good as mine. And my younger son here is thinking, or speaking, why is archaeology so ambiguous? I think with this crowd, I don't really need to explain why. With my students, it comes up an awful lot of times. Very many times, we just sort of have to shrug our shoulders and say, you know, we don't really know. But given that equation, I prefer to see this as a storage room that probably had a shrine in it, or some kind of sacred corner, or something like that. Again, unfortunately, given the nature of the records we have, I can't even say if there was a corner. We don't know where that cluster of ritual objects were found within the room, or even if they were clustered within the room. I mean, we know they came from the room, but was there a cluster within the room? We don't know how they related to each other. They could have been, the room itself was in use for at least a century, so they might not even have been contemporary. So again, there are many ambiguities that are built into our interpretive processes here. But like I said, it's not going to stop me. So this is one of the, what I would call a ritualized object. It's the fragment of a Phoenician jug. And the reason why I put it in this ritualized category is that it is the only imported ceramic for that entire compound. So in all of those five houses, this is the only single artifact that seems to have been imported to the site, at least from a distance. And site-wide, so outside of that compound, there are only sort of four of its cousins that are around. So I did a study on the Phoenician imports to the site, and there seem to have only been five, maybe six, now that I've been able to do some work in the Rockefeller as well, but the numbers are not high. And the fact that this is out of all of those houses, this is the only imported object, I think, means that it was of importance. At least it was expensive compared to the locally made jugs, and probably had some kind of use clustered in that room with other ritual objects in the pouring of liquids as a ritual offering. So that's the Phoenician jug. We also had the fragments of a minimum count, at least, of two pillar figurines. So here you can see nicely tattooed on her upper chest from room 513. The fragmentary version, for those of you who are not familiar, on the right-hand side of this slide, you can see one of the more complete, or actually the only complete version that was found from Nazbeh itself. So they were also present in this room. We have two, there's also a base as well. The interpretation of these pillar figurines, excuse me, is rife with all kinds of problems. But for the people who study figurines outside of this region and outside of this time period, there are basically five categories that have been set up for the interpretation of figurines in general. And so the first interpreted category is that they can represent a deity or some kind of divine being. The second category is that they can represent some sort of messenger or somebody that, or something that brings messages to the divine realm. The third one is that they can actually be used as toys. The fourth one is that they can be used as instructive tools, so you can use your figurines to sort of help teach, especially kids. And then the fifth thing is that they're also found in tombs and can represent ancestors. So I leave it up to you to decide. Although I'd have to say that those first two categories seem to catch most of the interpretations that have been foisted on these figurines. So scholars either think that they represent a female deity, or that they were used as some sort of messenger, or could represent actually a worshiper itself. So whether these are even divine or not is up in question. I tend to lean on the side that they do have some sort of ritual or sacred element to them. That gesture of the cupping of the breasts has a very long history in this region from the Neolithic period down through the Roman period. For the Iron Age, the data is a little bit more ambiguous, but we have earlier examples here on the left, clearly of representations of goddesses who are cupping their breasts. And then from more or less contemporary Iron Age societies that are outside of the region of Judah. Here you can see, I think it's from a horse blinder, an Aramean horse blinder, actually three goddesses, see in the upper part of the slide, each one of whom is cupping her breasts, supported by yet another goddess. And then in relatively recent finds from the site of Yavne, you can see again nude female figures on the corner of this model shrine, also cupping their breasts. So I'm not sure that this sort of helps us decide which one of these categories our pillar figurines can fall into, but that gesture seems to have ritual overtones. And especially when we put it into greater context. Now, part of the problem with those making those nice, neat categories, there are five ways to interpret figurines, is that you can have crossovers between different categories. So for instance, there's a study of the use of figurines in modern South Asian households. They have rituals that take place in the kitchen. And figurines, like the ones that you see here, modern ones on the right-hand side of this slide, that are used and represent lesser deities in the Hindu pantheon, so they're used in household rituals, are also played by the kids of the house. So is that a toy or is that a goddess? And the answer is it's both, depending on what time and, you know, sort of what the context is within the household. Another issue in terms of interpretation, or another example of those sort of cross-cutting as well, is that this notion that figurines can be messengers that send prayers up to the divine realm is all well and good, but those messengers can also be divine beings. We have plenty of examples of that from the Hebrew Bible and from the ancient Near East, where it is divine beings themselves, divinities, that are doing the message taking. So that, again, I mean, so a figurine could be a messenger, but it could also be a divine messenger. And that's an example that crosses between those nice, neat categories. So then a third example that also sort of deconstructs or messes up these nice categories is the notion that also comes from studies of modern traditional figurine production and use in traditional South Asia, where figurines like the ones you see here on the right-hand side of the slide are purposely manufactured in a generic way by professional potters. And then it's the consumers who bring meaning to these figurines. So they're made in a generic way so that people can buy them, bring them home, and sort of put their own meanings on what they represent. And it makes me wonder, too, if something like that might have been going on in ancient Judah, where we have these mold-made heads, we have the pinched heads as well. And studies have shown that these figurines were likely made not in the households themselves, but in pottery workshops. So perhaps these ancient Judean potters were creating things, these figurines, in a generalized fashion so that individuals could purchase them, so to speak, bring them home, and use them in varied ways. It's an easier way to sell things, right, if it's not that specific. But it makes it more difficult for us as moderns to try and put an individual interpretation on these ancient artifacts. So welcome to the pleasures of figurine studies, right? Next, please. Okay. Now, perhaps related, so studies by Carol Myers and others have related those female figurines to women's religious culture that was especially taking place in households. And I think that's a very interesting interpretation when one looks at other artifacts from that same room. For instance, these two boar's tusks that I've shown here in the upper right. So those were both found in room 513. Sarah Kanza, who's an archaeozoologist, looked at them and determined that they are from boars, but they're from the same side of the mouth. Boars only have one tusk on each side, so these represent at least two different animals, same side of the mouth, which is kind of interesting. So are these things ritual? Are they special? They're definitely unusual. And I was sort of facing a quandary about how to, and still do, actually, about how to interpret them. There's very little material that we know about connecting boars or swine with the realm of the ritual. But there is some. They appear to, in other Near Eastern contexts, to have had apoptotic qualities of warding off evil. They also are connected, as is a bunch of stuff, to fertility or fecundity, and also boars are famous for, at least the females are famous for, suckling many pigs at the same time. And that's important to remember too, because there are interpretive aspects to those female figurines that are cupping their engorged breasts related specifically to lactation. So keep that in mind. Because it's interesting when one looks again at modern traditional uses of boar's tusks. So in Morocco, that kind of curved shape is important because it's representative of the crescent moon. Across the Mediterranean in traditional Spain, boar's tusks are made into amulets that women wear around their necks, and the importance there is actually because of the color. The creamy color is associated with breast milk and is worn by women in order to increase the production of breast milk. So is that what's going on in ancient Judah? Perhaps. I bring in some other ancient evidence as well. Here we have one of the images from Pithos at Cantilla d'Ajrud, more or less contemporary with our households here at Telen Nazbe. And you can see the sort of famous scene we have of the sacred tree with the wild goats nibbling and its edges on top of a lion. This is a constellation of representations that are typically attributed to the goddess Khonsu, at least earlier on. But right above the sacred tree, here you can see the representation of a wild boar, and you can even see its tusks as well, perhaps deliberately placed in relationship to this kind of sacred cluster of imagery. And the goddess Khonsu herself has been, and this is also greatly argued over, but is associated perhaps with the goddess Asherah. And there's a very long literature associating the goddess Asherah, who appears, at least her symbol, which you probably can see here represented on this pithos, the composite or stylized tree is mentioned numerous times in the Hebrew Bible. And she has, of course, relations as the mother goddess to fertility, to protection of childbirth, etc., etc. So again, could that be a possible interpretive path for our boar's tusks from this room? Maybe. I feel like I'm climbing out the, I can't remember who it was, but in the 50s there was a British archaeologist who talked about the ladder of inference. And so I kind of feel like I'm precariously almost not balanced out there as you sort of you layer inference on top of inference, but it's all sort of part of the fun. And then thinking about the color, the importance of this cream color, made me also consider these Judean and Israelite pendants that we find at sites in the Iron II period as well that are made out of bone. So perhaps these pendants, none of which came from this room that I'm talking about, but they're found at the site itself of Das Bay and many other contemporary sites. Perhaps the color itself was important, and perhaps these symbols, as opposed to being some sort of apotropaic eye symbol, may have been related to breasts and to lactation. So moving a little bit away, tacking away from the world of the female, we have a representation of a male face. You can tell that by the beard. I hope you can see that. It's a fragmentary, probably a plaque. Here you can see a nice portion of a round edge. So it would have been a circular clay plaque. You can see the nose and the lips. And it's possible that this is some kind of representation of the god Bes. We have here, unfortunately, a headless amulet from the site of Nazbe itself. There are also Bes representations at Kintel Adashrud and other kinds of figurines like this one found at many Judean sites itself. And while it is Bes is a male deity, he was important in Egypt for the protection of mothers, the protection of children, and in general for the well-being of the household. So here we have another kind of interpretive rung on this ladder. Oops, sorry. Okay. From that same room, there was one highly fragmentary. I can call it, I mean, it really is the figurine of a horse, but we know that there was a male rider on it because he, I hope, can see the representation of a portion of the leg that would have straddled this fragment, and then there's a whole version here. These have been less of a focus, I would say, than the female figurines, but are also equally argued about. Does this male figure represent some kind of deity, or is he some sort of warrior, a profane warrior figure on a horse? Is it a messenger to the gods? I would say all of these interpretations are out there. Again, if we look at modern-day traditional South Asia, there's some interesting parallels. They also have horse and rider figurines that are used. In the case of modern-day India, these figurines do represent lesser deities in the Hindu pantheon that were messenger gods in specific. But just because it's a male figurine, again, you can actually go and talk to living people. And these are used in India both by women and by men. So while the figurine itself is gendered, the use of the figurine is not unique to one gender or the other. One thing we can say for Tel Nazbe, again, given the breadth of excavation, is that these occur much less frequently than the female pillar figurines do. So site-wide, there are something like 23 of these that were found in comparison to 140 of the pillar figurines. So whatever they were related to seems to have been happening in a much smaller percentage than whatever the female figurines were related to. So I think that's of interest as well. When we move out a little bit from, so again, I've been focusing in on room 513, our only real cluster, and look at the presence of where the other female figurines, the pillar figurines, are found. First of all, there are at least two, a minimum number, in 513, and notice that it is located just south of the room that I've interpreted as the summer kitchen. And then the other three female pillar figurines from this particular five-room compound are all found within this same house, the one that contains the other, probably the winter kitchen for this compound. The context, especially outside of room 513, is a little bit shaky, but I think this is interesting patterning. And even if you look at outside of these two blue circles that I've created, or whatever they are, rounded rectangles, there are very few ritual items that are found at least outside of those two buildings themselves. And so it's possible, again, following the work of Carol Myers, Cynthia Schaefer Elliott, sitting in the back here, that because the kitchens and cooking themselves are gendered as female space. And so one can imagine, with this clustering also of female figurines, that perhaps it was the woman, the sort of the elder statesperson of this compound, who was in charge of the sort of the physical feeding of the families, the extended family that lived in this compound, but also may have been in charge of the ritual protection of the people who lived in these buildings as well. And there are anthropologists who associate the division of domestic power and domestic authority. So within the buildings themselves, within the private realm of the household, again, in traditional Mediterranean societies, it's the woman who has the domestic power over what happens within those walls. In the more public arena, outside of the houses themselves, in public spaces, it's the male head of household who has the authority. And so we might imagine, again, within the context inside the houses, that it was the head female of the household who had control not only over the cooking and the sustenance of the people living within these houses, but also had control over the ritual well-being of these people as well, whereas the male role was played outside of these domestic spheres. Excuse me. So just a few more objects that are sort of don't have parallels from within that one room, 513. So these were found outside of that, but provide some other unique insights into possible rituals that were going on within that compound. An unusual seven-spouted clay lamp that came from one of the cisterns. Here you can see that. So it was used in rituals that involved light. And then fragments here that I'd used before as an illustration for the distance between 10 meters between these two fragments were found of a fenestrated stand used for the lighting of incense. And here you see a much more complete version from the site of Megiddo there in the upper right. And you probably can't quite see it, but there also was the spout of a zoomorphic vessel, again used for the pouring of liquids, presumably libations, if you want to put it in ritual speak, was found as well outside of that room. So a representation, I would say, of great variety within that one compound. And eventually, I'm working on right now expanding this study to look at the same kinds of questions site-wide for the Iron II period. We have an even greater variety of materials. These are all from Tel Nazbe. You can see some recent shots that I took during my research stay here this spring from the Rockefeller. Other objects like rattles in the upper left, stone amulets in the upper right, clay model couch there in the middle on the right. This is actually very interesting. It's a fragment of a double horse and rider. I don't know if you can see it. So it's the rear end of the horse. There's only one body represented, but it has two tails, in this case, two fragments. An incense stand, and that's part of a Kernos there in the lower right. So eventually, I'll be able to expand this to look at other contemporary houses, see what kind of patterning is going on there, not just with the ritual materials, but also with the more profane artifacts as well. And we can tie that into, from the sort of household level to a site-wide level, also what's going on, thinking about community level of religion, regional levels of religion, national levels as well. So I think with all these varied aspects, it helps to really kind of flesh out the picture of the diversity of religion in ancient Judah and ancient Israel. And just as a reminder too, these common households, the quote unquote, the sort of the poor people of this region, made up at least a minimum of 85% of this ancient culture. So what I've sort of tiptoed into describing today really are aspects